Today, we're not going to be talking about every item on the Middle East policy agenda. We're going to be focusing on just one, but it might be the most important. It is the challenge from Iran. It is a multifaceted challenge. It is a challenge that begins but doesn't end with the Iranian nuclear program. It is a challenge that stretches and touches every corner of the Middle East, from Beirut to Gaza to the Arab Gulf. It is a challenge that has implications for American security interests, implications for American economic interests, for our strategic interests, and of course for our partnerships. Our partnerships in the Arab world. There are many Arab countries that are whose leaders and strategic thinkers wake up in the morning anxious and nervous about the growing influence of Islamist Iran, as well as our friends in Israel. For whom the Iranian threat is no mere theoretical mirage on the horizon, but rather something real and something that has more implications, deeper implications, existential implications in a way that it has for no other country in the world. It is a with great pride that I share a podium today with these four colleagues of mine. Their biographies are listed in brief in your programs. I'm not going to read to you what you have in front of you. I just want to say a word about each of them as they come up for their presentations. First, I'm going to turn to the Deputy Director for Research at the Washington Institute, Dr. Patrick Clawson. Patrick is someone I have known for many, many years in Washington. He is, I think, everybody who knows Patrick will tell you, he's one of the smartest people in Washington. Patrick is an economist by training. Patrick speaks, reads, and writes fluent Persian. He worked for the International Monetary Fund, for the World Bank, for the Defense Department's National Defense University, where he was a strategic thinker for the Institute for National Security Studies. He has written on everything from the cocaine trade in Latin America to 16th century Persian numismatics. Those are little coins, if you don't know. But most importantly, and of most relevance for today, Patrick is without a doubt one of our nation's leading experts on the politics and strategy of dealing with the Islamic Republic of Iran. Patrick serves on the advisory board of the Sandia National Laboratories. Patrick has a special national security clearance, which gives him access to some of our nation's most secret nuclear secrets, because we are trying to understand how best to deal with our adversaries and how to prepare ourselves appropriately for what might need to come someday. It is with great pride that I can turn the podium first over to my colleague, Patrick Clawson.
Our panel this afternoon is entitled The Challenge of Iran. And before my learned colleagues give you great details about the specifics of that challenge, permit me to say a few words of an overview about what is the challenge of Iran. I'm sure we all think about the Iranian nuclear program, but let me point out to you some of the other challenges that we face from Iran. About a month ago, in a one-week period, more than 200 rockets rained down on Israel, including 20 rockets of long enough range that they could reach the city of Ashkelon. And those rockets had not, the long-range ones, had not been made in the Gaza Strip. They did not come from the moon. They came from our Iranian friends, who are busy trying to turn Hamas from a ragtag group of terrorists into a group of sophisticated fighters, on the model of what they did with Hezbollah in Lebanon over years, forming and shaping that group, which was most unimpressive to begin with, into people who fought quite well during the summer 2006 war. And This is an important aspect of how Iran is putting serious resources, military resources and financial resources, behind its words about destroying Israel. Iran doesn't just talk about destroying Israel. Iran is busily engaged in training, arming, and financing those who are dedicated to that objective. Then further north, we find Hezbollah's leader, Nasrallah, who has recently said that Hezbollah now has 40,000 rockets. 40,000 rockets. This is a man who has not generally been known to exaggerate Hezbollah's military accomplishments. And indeed, Hezbollah has also been constructing an impressive network of defensive systems and of bunkers in the area north of the Litani River outside the UNIFIL control. Hezbollah is also threatening Lebanon's democracy. The Lebanese government of Fuad Siyara is hanging by a thread. Lebanon has not had a president since November because Hezbollah has been blocking the election of a president by the Lebanese parliament. And I hope we can all remember that by Hezbollah's account, by Iran's account, and by the account of outside observers, the Hezbollah organization was formed in the 1980s at the direct order of Iran. Then, a couple of weeks ago, there was a lot of fighting going on across southern Iraq. And there were hundreds and hundreds, if not more than 1,000 people killed in that fighting. And what the U.S. forces tell us, and frankly most of the U.S. press hasn't gotten very right, although the L.A. Times has been much better than most, is that this fighting was led primarily by the special groups in the Mahdi Army. These special groups in the Mahdi Army are, according to the U.S. evaluation, under the direct control of the Revolutionary Guard force from Iran, their Al-Quds force. These special groups are not controlled by Muqtada al-Sadr. Muqtada al-Sadr has sent several messages, letters to U.S. officials saying this. And indeed, you may notice that General Petraeus and Ambassador Crocker have said positive things about Muqtada al-Sadr in recent months because of their evaluation that the real problems that we are facing from the these militia forces inside Iraq are coming from these special groups that are controlled by the Revolutionary Guards. And it is the U.S. evaluation that what Iran is trying to do is to build up these special groups until they can take over and push aside Muqtada al-Sadr, who, as an Iraqi nationalist, has got an ambiguous relationship with the Iranians, on whom he is so dependent at the moment, but whom he does not particularly like. And what Iran would prefer to have is a group of puppets, much as what the Iranians did in the 1980s when forming Hezbollah in Lebanon was to push aside the authentic Lebanese leadership of the Shia community in the Amal movement led by Nabi Berri, to sideline them by creating their own group. In Lebanon, it was Hezbollah. That is what the Iranians seem to be trying to do in Iraq. So what I've laid out here is that Iran is a threat to Israel. It's a threat to Lebanon. It's a threat to Iraq. And it's a threat to U.S. interests throughout the entire region. Why is Iran interfering so far away from its borders? What possible interest does Iran have in doing this? Well, unfortunately, the Islamic Republic of Iran has tapped into and perverted an important strand of nationalism in the Iranian psyche. We tend to see Iran as a mid-sized country that excels at causing trouble, whereas the Iranians see themselves as a great civilization that's fallen on hard times in recent centuries. May I remind you that the first marathon was run to bring the news of the desperate struggle against the powerful Iranian army that was invading Europe. And if you have a chance to go to India, I hope you see that beautiful building, the Taj Mahal, and you admire the wonderful inscriptions on it, every one of which is written in Persian, because that was the language spoken by the people who built it. And the next time you're at the Western Wall, go back and take a look at who the Bible says paid for that second temple. It was Cyrus, the ruler of Persia. So in the Iranian psyche, it's very different from that of the Arabs. Bernard Lewis has captured the Arab complaint that we were once a great people, say the Arabs, and we are not now, and it's the West's fault. Persian attitude is, we were once a great people, we still are, and why aren't you giving us the respect that's due to us? Therefore, there's this expectation that they will dominate a wide region around them. The Islamic Republic has tapped into and perverted this, adding to it a very dangerous Islamic element. Many of the leaders of the Islamic Republic are firmly convinced that the Iranian revolutionaries are the natural leaders of the world's 1.4 billion Muslims, and that they have God on their side and will eventually win. When former UN Secretary General Kofi Annan did a goodbye tour of the world before leaving office, he stopped in Tehran. And as the New York Times account described it, Iranian President Ahmadinejad complained to Kofi Annan that the structures of the United Nations reflect too much the way the world was in 1945. Ahmadinejad added, Britain and the United States may have won the last world war, but we will win the next one. That rather surprised Kofi Annan, who didn't even know there was going to be a next world war. And this is indeed the extent of their ambitions. So they, however, are overreaching, because their goals are not the goals of the Iranian people. The Iranian people want to join the world. They want to enjoy the prosperity and the interaction with the rest of the world, which they hunger, and for which these aggressive policies of the Islamic Republic have prevented them from enjoying. Even the reformers within the Islamic Republic, that is to say, people who are firmly committed to the Islamic Republic, but who realize that there's got to be some change if that system is going to persist, they understand the dangers of provoking the neighbors and the great powers. And they see that Iran's actions in the last few years have so unsettled the region that countries in the Middle East have ordered $60 billion worth of arms in the last 2 years. And that's just the openly acknowledged deals. There are quiet rumors of tens of billions of dollars of other deals that have been done. So I'm painting a picture of an Iran which is quite a challenge and quite a problem. But to tell you the truth, all of this is not the main threat from Iran's nuclear program. Because the main threat from Iran's nuclear program is not Iran. It is the threat that the Iranian breakout from the non-proliferation treaty will lead to a breakdown in that treaty, and that we will live in a proliferated world with dozens of countries with nuclear weapons. If Iran can exploit the non-proliferation treaty to develop nuclear weapons without paying much of a cost, many others may. For instance, in the Middle East, nervous about Iran, there could well be this Middle East arms race that's already going on might well go nuclear. Certainly, many people in the region suspect that Saudi Arabia has a quiet deal with Pakistan. Saudi Arabia has got long-range missiles that are made by China that are designed to carry nuclear warheads. And many think that Pakistan would provide those warheads if Iran's program proceeds. Saudi Arabia goes nuclear, that's an unacceptable challenge to Egyptians' pretensions to lead the Arab world, so would they. And so, for that matter, might Turkey. If Turkey goes nuclear, there goes Greece. You see how this cascade effect can lead the non-proliferation system to fall apart, and indeed around the world. It's sobering to realize that the Secretary General of the ruling party of Japan has repeatedly said that Japan should reactivate its nuclear program faced with the North Korean threat, and that Taiwan periodically has debates about developing nuclear weapons to fend off mainland China. Argentina and Brazil both have presidents who said that it was a mistake to stop their nuclear programs, and that most unstable person, Mr. Chavez, is talking about admiring many things in Iran, which he's been to now six times, including their nuclear program. A world, with many nuclear states would run the risk of miscalculations, misperceptions that lead to the horror of nuclear war. And that is why some of the most prominent figures in American strategic thinking, ranging from Henry Kissinger to Sam Nunn and George Shultz, are involved in a major effort to move the world away from nuclear weapons altogether. And there is no greater risk of a nuclear world with many nuclear states than Iran, which breaks out of the non-proliferation treaty. I think it's useful if those of us who are particularly concerned about the threat to Israel bear this in mind in talking to our friends so that we can explain why it is that an Iran with nuclear weapons is such a vital threat to the United States. Because even if you think that, well, Iran, we can deal with it, do we want to live in a world where every Tom, Dick, and Harry has a nuclear weapon? I don't think so. I don't think that that's in U.S. interests. And stopping that proliferation has been the main objective of the great powers and the main reason that our European friends have been so tough about this issue. Well, I've been going on too long. Let's talk a little bit more specifically about Iran and its objectives. And let me turn first to my colleague, Mehdi Khalaji. Mehdi is particularly uniquely suited to tell us about the Iranian leaders. He had the pleasure earlier in his life of spending 14 years studying in the Qom seminaries. So, please, Mehdi.
I have spent many months in 2007 working on a paper about the religious mentality of Iranian leaders and its impact on the political decision-making. During the years I'm in the West, in general, I'm hearing very much that the Muslims in the Islamic world are mostly their action is driving by their ideology. And the Western media, Western scholars, they give lots of credit to the Islamic ideology as the main motivation of the social political behaviors of the Muslim in Islamic world. Regarding to Iranian situation, we have described Iranian regime as a fundamentalist ideological regime which has a special set of ideological beliefs which leads to a very specific kind of political action. The question I'm dealing with here is that to what extent ideology drives the political action of Iranian leaders. When Ayatollah Khomeini came to power in Iran in 1979, he promised Iranian people different kind of promises. economic, cultural, and political. He told people that by establishing an Islamic government, he will bring this world happiness and that world salvation for all Iranian citizens. But shortly after the establishment of Islamic revolution, Ayatollah Khomeini found out that it is not possible to rule the country based on Islamic law. A very famous theory of Ayatollah Khomeini is the theory of the velayat-e-faqih, or the guardianship of the Shiite jurist. Many people in the West and even in Islamic world, they have misunderstood this theory. They thought that by the theory of the leadership of jurist, Ayatollah Khomeini meant that a prominent jurist, has the right to implement Islamic law. The statements of Ayatollah Khomeini, as well as the history of Iranian government, shows that this perception is not true. By guardianship of jurist, Ayatollah Khomeini meant that a prominent jurist, or a most knowledgeable jurist, has the right and authority to overrule Islamic law if he sees Islamic law against the interest of regime. So, according to Ayatollah Khomeini and then to his successor, Ayatollah Khamenei, the current Iranian supreme leader, the priority is for the regime's interest, not for the Islamic law. Many followers of Ayatollah Khomeini have explicitly stated that even in the conflict between the Iranian regime and the principle of the unity of God, we have to suspend the principle of unity of God and go for the interest of regime. So basically it says that according to the ideology of the Iranian government, there is no ideology, and in principle there is no principle. Groucho Marx has a very famous phrase in which he says that these are my principles. If you don't like them, I have others. So, especially after the failure of Islamic ideology, after the Iran-Iraq war, Iranian leaders found out that the framework of the Islamic law cannot be imposed. It's unable to provide an effective system for the economy, culture, and politics. Iranian leaders' soft power has been really weakened during the last three decades in Iran. Islamic propaganda, state media, and other means failed to provide people with satisfaction about their situation inside the country, and failed to disseminate the Islamic values. If you go to Tehran, if you go to Iran, to different cities of Iran, you will find that Iran, in terms of social and moral values, is much less Islamic than much of Islamic countries. Overruling Islamic law, it's not just a political statement. It has been institutionalized in the political structure of Iranian regime. There is a very important body in the in Iran, which is called Expediency Council. The main job of Expediency Council is to veto the decisions made by the Guardian Council. Guardian Council examine the bill which is passed by the parliament, examine the whether they are are correspondent to the Islamic law or Iranian constitution. Many times the Guardian Council says that this bill is not compatible with Islamic law. When Guardian Council decided to avoid this bill, Expediency Council can veto his decision and says that despite the fact that this bill is against the Islamic law, but because it is in the interest of regime, so we have to adopt this bill. So overruling Islamic law has been institutionalized in the Islamic Republic. Of course, Iranian leaders are religious. They are coming from a religious background, but there are many differences between different factions inside the government. For example, the president, Ahmadinejad, is coming from a religious family, a traditional family, but he does not have any religious training. Unlike him, Ayatollah Khamenei is coming from a clerical family, and he has been trained in at the Mashhad Seminary, one of the most important seminaries in Shiite world. But ironically, Ayatollah Khamenei is much more secular than the President Ahmadinejad. President Ahmadinejad is very committed to an apocalyptic vision in which he believed that the Shiite Messiah will return very soon and will establish the just government over the earth and will remove the evil government from all around the world. And according to the interpretation of the Ahmadinejad, the decline of Zionism or removal of the Zionism can be seen as one of the measures that a Shiite believer has to take in order to hasten the return of hidden Imam. But as I explained in this long study, Ayatollah Khamenei does not hold any apocalyptic vision. Ayatollah Khamenei, as the supreme leader of Iranian regime, is much more pragmatist, and we have to define pragmatism, of course, because pragmatism, according to Ayatollah Khamenei, is much different than the pragmatism according to John Dewey in US. The main difference is, according to Ayatollah Khamenei, the survival of the regime is very important. Ayatollah Khamenei deeply and extremely cares for the survival of the regime and his position. But according to Ahmadinejad, the survival of the regime is not a big deal because the Shiite Messiah comes and saves all of us. And so he's thinking about something bigger, and he's in his Persian New Year message to the nation, Ahmadinejad said that this year is the year of global management. So we want to manage the world. We want to think about the return of hidden Imam. But in the speeches of Ayatollah Khamenei, you hardly find anything, any reference to the Shiite Messiah or his return. pragmatism of Ayatollah Khamenei doesn't make him an easy man. It makes him more complicated and more difficult to predict, because when we are in front of a man who is thinking within a very specific framework, we can understand him, we can predict him, we can have some sort of dialogue with him. But if you are in front of somebody who does not believe in anything in principle, so it's very difficult for you to negotiate with him, to predict his future action, his next move. So there is nothing that you can rely on in your deal with him. We have heard a lot from Iranian leaders that, according to the religious creeds of Islam, or religious creeds of Ayatollahs in Iran, building a nuclear bomb or production of the mass destruction weapons is illegal in Islam. Based on what I just said, I would say that this is not true. According to Islam, you can make bomb, even nuclear bomb, and you can produce mass destruction weapons, especially when you have a serious enemy who has the same weapon. You know this Revolutionary Guard, this Revolutionary Army of the Iranian regime. In the logo on the uniform of the Revolutionary Guard is written a verse of Quran, in which it says that it orders, God orders the all Muslim worshippers that you have to be equipped with the most advanced weapons of the time in order to frighten your enemy and the enemy of God. So this verse has been a basis for the adoption or for the legalization of the mass destruction weapons in many of the writings of Iranian clerics and Iranian ideologues. So, according to Shiism, these religious texts or sacred texts, they are silent if you don't give any interpretation. This is the interpretations which give lives to the text. So there is nothing inherent in the text itself. This is your interpretation that gives sense to this text. So if you are advocating war, you can give a pro-war interpretation to the text. If you are pro-peace, so you can give a peaceful interpretation from the text. So that was the case from the beginning of Islamic Republic in Iran. The clerics, especially the Iranian leaders, they are justifying their political approach or their political actions by the text. They don't care about what text says itself. They care about what are their interests. And according to their interest, they try to interpret the Islam. That's why the religious text after three decades have become very exhausted, and it's very difficult to convince Iranian people that this Quran or the tradition of Prophet says this or that. Many people in Iran, they found out that this is the interest of regime which matters, not the text themselves. So my conclusion is there is no ideology in Iran. Islamic ideology have failed inside the society and has nothing to offer to Iranian people and Iranian young generation. And especially in the minds of leaders, there is nothing, or the key leaders, if we just exclude Ahmadinejad and Ahmadinejad's faction, they don't care about ideology as many other ideological group or fundamentalists in the region care about that. They mostly care about the survival of the regime, about the expansion of their power in the region and inside the country. And since they lack the soft power, whether inside the country or outside, they mostly rely on the hard power. That's the only option they have to survive. Thank you.
Good afternoon. If you want a foretaste of how Iran's acquisition of nuclear weapons could affect the Islamic Republic of Iran and the region, look around you now. We're already seeing the consequences of Iran's technological successes in the nuclear arena in the form of an emboldened Iran and the region adjusting to this reality. Now, I want to make it clear that as far as we know, Iran is not yet a nuclear weapon state. Still, despite all its flaws, the most authoritative document we have on this subject was the U.S. intelligence community's national intelligence estimate that was published in last December. And according to the NIE, Iran will not have enough domestically produced fissile material for a bomb until at least 2010 and perhaps as far distant as 2015. Although I just want to caveat that by saying that this does not rule out the possibility that Iran might acquire fissile material from abroad, and whether it be North Korea, former Soviet Union, or Pakistan, and perhaps for all we know may have already have done so. But as far as we know, in terms of their own domestic production capability, they are not yet a nuclear weapon state. But Iran's behavior indicates that it is that it's increasingly confident that it is on its way to becoming a nuclear weapon state, that there is nothing that the U.S. or the international community can do about it, and that the region and the world will simply have to adjust to this reality. Now, a couple of years ago, we used to talk about when we reach the time in which we are in a nuclear transition with Iran, this gray zone in which Iran's actual nuclear status is not clear. It's ambiguous, kind of similar to the situation we were in for much of the 1990s with North Korea, when we thought it was possible that North Korea might have a nuke, one or two nukes, and we didn't know until they finally tested it a few years ago. Well, I think we already are entering that gray zone right now with Iran. And I think I'll just give you two quotes that were made by President Ahmadinejad recently on this point, which I think illustrate this. First, he said recently that Iran is already a nuclear power. And it's very interesting. When he uses the term nuclear power, I think it's clear that on a certain level, he's clearly referring to Iran's what they are claiming is a civilian nuclear program, but he uses the term power in an ambiguous way in order to cast fear and cast doubts and raise questions about Iran's ultimate intentions and capabilities and to implant fear in the hearts of Iran's adversaries and enemies. He also said recently that, and this second quote further deepens the ambiguity, Iran's nuclear program contributes to Iran's deterrent capability. Now, that's interesting. How does a civilian nuclear program contribute to Iran's nuclear capability unless there are doubts in the minds of its neighbors, and perhaps unless Iran harbors intentions to use this program to produce nuclear weapons? And we have various manifestations of this growing Iranian self-confidence, and Patrick mentioned a few of them before. Iran's support for the special groups in Iraq that are involved in attacks on American forces there. The seizure of British sailors in the Shatt al-Arab last year. The harassment of American shipping in the Strait of Hormuz as well, and also Iran's deepening role in the Palestinian arena. Now, I just want to make it clear that Iran's growing self-confidence and assertiveness is not just due to its maturing nuclear program. There's also the growing confidence that they derive from the fact that the United States is bogged down in Iraq and high oil prices. But I would argue that I think it's probably its progress in the nuclear arena which is the most important factor in its growing self-confidence. And I want to say that this is also not an isolated phenomenon. We've seen in the past with other states that were either well on their way to acquiring nuclear weapons or had already acquired nuclear weapons, a change in their foreign policy towards greater activism and assertiveness and aggression. And I'll give you two examples. The first one is Saddam Hussein's Iraq after the Iran-Iraq War, where we saw, instead of Iraq turning inward and focusing on post-war reconstruction, they actually adopted a more active and more aggressive regional posture, ultimately culminating in the invasion of Kuwait, in large part, at least in my mind, due to the maturing of their weapons of mass destruction programs, that is their chemical and biological program, but especially their nuclear program. And likewise, we saw that after Pakistan tested their nuclear weapon in 1998, they were within a few short years involved in two major crises with India. First, a crisis in 1999 where Pakistan, probably emboldened by the perception of strength conferred by their nuclear weapons program, tried to seize a toehold in the Kargil region in a part of in a territory that is currently held by India but disputed by both Pakistan or claimed by both Pakistan and India. And then several years, and that led to a major crisis between the two countries which almost led to war. And then we saw several years later in December 2001 the attack on the Indian parliament by terrorist groups that were supported by Pakistan and based in Pakistan, although there is no indication that the Pakistani government supported the attack, but it allowed them to operate at the time, and there was an attack on the Indian parliament, and that led to another major crisis between the two countries. Now, in terms of regional reactions to Iran, which is approaching a nuclear capability, first let's talk about Iran's immediate neighbors, which are the Gulf Arab countries and Turkey. And there are, I think, three ways in which these countries can respond to Iran's developing nuclear potential. First, ensure that they have at least correct relations with Iran, if not warm relations, in order to prevent them from becoming a target of Iranian aggression. And we've seen, actually, in just the last few weeks, two remarkable instances of the regional countries trying to qualitatively change their relationship with Iran. First, the invitation that was extended to President Ahmadinejad to the Gulf Cooperation Council summit that was held, and then recently their invitation to attend the Arab summit in Damascus. These are really remarkable developments when looked at in historical perspective. And it shows, I think, the degree to which a more assertive Iran is being met with a policy of palliation, if you will, on the part of some of its neighbors. Secondly, some of them might try to develop an independent deterrent capability. Patrick mentioned a major conventional military buildup that we're seeing in the region, as well as the possibility that many of these countries might pursue a nuclear option in the future. And we've already heard the Gulf Cooperation Council states, Turkey, Jordan, Egypt, announcing that they will revive their civilian nuclear programs. There's also the speculation that Saudi, as Patrick said, the Saudis might decide to host Pakistani nuclear weapons, although there are all kinds of problems with that. I'm not sure that's a likely outcome, that is, but that is a possibility that people have been talking about. And then finally, the final option for these countries in adjusting to the emergence of a nuclear Iran is to improve relations with the United States, which right now I think this is an area that the United States has been working on to try to create a regional security architecture under the American aegis to deal with a emerging nuclear Iran. I think we may not have had as much progress in this regard as we would have liked. And I think it will probably fall to a new administration in order to make more progress in this area than the current administration has been able to do thus far. Patrick talked about the possibility of a regional nuclear arms race, which increases the chance of a nuclear event, as well as I would mention the leakage of nuclear materials to non-state actors. I would also mention the possibility of Iranian leakage or Iranian proliferation. We've already heard the Supreme Leader saying that Iran would be glad to share its nuclear technology. They say they use the term peaceful nuclear technology with other Islamic states. And I would simply make the point that nearly every nuclear program, every nuclear weapons program that exists historically has led in some way to another nuclear program. We saw this with the United American program that, as a result of espionage, contributed to the Soviet program, through assistance helped the French and British programs. We saw that the Soviets helped the Chinese helped the Pakistanis through Abdulkadir Khan have helped the North Koreans, the Iranians, and the Libyans. France helped Israel. So this is a historical trend, and I think it would be unrealistic to believe that Iran will not also behave accordingly. In terms of Israel's response, Israel faces painful decisions considering the possibility of preventive military action. And there are all kinds of issues related to whether this is this a doable option? Does Israel have the intelligence required to do it? Does its aircraft have sufficient range to strike all the targets that need to be hit and to strike them multiple times in order to make sure that the job is done right? Can they hit deeply buried and hardened targets in order to produce a sufficient level of destruction in order to have push the program back more than just a few years? And then there's a whole issue of timing. This is an administration which is the Bush administration, which is seen in Israel as historically, in an unprecedented way, sympathetic to Israel's security concerns, at least on this issue. And should they strike while this administration is still in office, will this option be closed with the emergence of a new administration, or will this option remain open with the new administration? There's a whole issue of Israel recasting its own deterrent posture with regard to its nuclear option. Do they continue with their policy of opacity that they've pursued successfully for several decades, or do they actually adopt an open posture of possession? What effect would the nuclear Iran have on Israel's freedom of action in Lebanon and the Palestinian areas if Iran attempts to extend a deterrent umbrella to Hezbollah or groups like Hamas and says to Israel, if you attack these groups, we will then defend them with all means at our disposal, with the implication being that they might use nuclear weapons in response? And then there's the issue of the impact of nuclear Iran on Israeli morale. And Deputy Defense Minister Ephraim Snell often paints a nightmare scenario of Israelis leaving the country because they don't want to live under the nuclear shadow. Investment in Israel stops. Tourism stops. I think this might be perhaps an overdrawn scenario, but I think a lot will depend on Israeli leadership in terms of the impact that such a development, if it were to happen in the future, has on Israeli morale. And then finally, the challenges that this development poses for the U.S. I think it's quite likely that in light of U.S. problems in Iraq and the publication of that national intelligence estimate, preventive action is probably not a viable option anymore for this administration, although, again, I would not absolutely take it off the table or rule it out. But I think that there's a fundamental problem in that prevention, to be a successful policy, has to be able to be sustained over time. It's not a one-time affair. And some people have talked that President Bush, and I don't know whether they know this from, at least this is a rumor that you see sometimes in the media, that President Bush, fears that he doesn't want to leave this challenge to a next administration. The problem is, for prevention to work, it has to be, even if he does it, there might have to be follow-on strikes by a subsequent administration. So there has to be political buy-in, bipartisan political buy-in, in a policy of prevention for prevention to work. And so therefore, I think that also argues against perhaps the president acting while he still remains in office. So I think it's likely that difficult choices or decisions about prevention will be handed over to the next administration. So I'll finish my presentation here with a prediction that I believe that no matter who is elected in November, because of Iran's centrality to various U.S. interests in Iraq, in Afghanistan, with regard to nuclear weapons proliferation, there will be a very strong temptation to reach out and dialogue with Tehran before considering other options, no matter who is elected president in November. And this won't happen until after the Iranian presidential election in June of 2009, so as not to give President Ahmadinejad a political boost. I think any administration will be very reluctant to reach out to Tehran just to avoid giving Ahmadinejad a boost that he could claim that, look, only I was able to talk to the United States and the U.S. came crawling to me, so that's why you need to elect me as president. So I think we're likely to see any kind of outreach to Tehran come only after the Iranian elections in June of 2009. And at that point, if diplomatic efforts don't bear fruit, depending on who is elected, we are likely to either see renewed U.S. efforts to create a regional security architecture designed to deter a nuclear Iran and or preventive action to forestall Iran's emergence as a nuclear weapon state, depending on who is president. Thank you.
To talk about the key relationship that might be the trigger, and now to talk about the key relationship that might be a trigger for one of these options that Mike
just discussed, we'll turn to Chuck Freilich, who's the author of this fantastic recent Institute publication called Speaking the Unspeakable, which I have on quite good account, is now making the rounds in the White House. Actually, the story goes that somebody called up and asked whether we could send over a dozen copies of Chuck's publication from the White House. And then 2 days later, they called me again and they said, can you send over 10 more copies? Which tells me two things. One, the copy machine in the White House is not working. And two, people are very interested in what Chuck has to say.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Iran is an existential threat to Israel. Iran is an existential threat to Israel. We hear that regularly. It's become almost a mantra on the part of Israeli leaders, and it's become one almost on the part of American leaders as well. It's something that we've stated repeatedly, and it's become an absolute truism. I'd like to begin my comments by taking a very, very firm stand and expressing my own opinion in the most unequivocal, clear, and straight way that I can, and say my own opinion, which is, well, maybe. The question is, under what circumstances? I think if you look at the record of the Islamic Republic of Iran since the revolution in 79, in most cases, Iran has behaved as a coldly calculating, careful, what we would call in the professional jargon, rational actor. They go about trying to pursue their goals in a well-thought-out way. We may not like the ideology. It certainly sounds extremist to our ears. But they go about pursuing this very effectively and very carefully. And when they run up against walls, they also know how to back down and back away and try and find different ways of pursuing their goals. Now, I would say that there are two exceptions to this general overall rule of rationality. One is Iranian policy towards the United States, and the other, even more so, is the policy towards Israel. The question, though, is if tomorrow morning, God forbid, we wake up and Iran has become a nuclear power, is that it for Israel? Is it curtains? Is it time to close down the whole show and move out? And we heard Mike mention Ephraim Snez's rather dire prediction. I think it is grossly overstated. Israel is thought to be a nuclear power in its own right. Well, assuming that that is the case, then for Iran to even contemplate a nuclear exchange with Israel means it has to be taking into account an exchange of Tel Aviv for Tehran. And who says it has to end there? If we're in the business of targeting, I could think of a lot of other nice places to attack. Are they willing to risk that kind of exchange? Let's say it's only Tehran. Well, the population of Tehran is something like 8 million people, and greater Tehran is over 10 million people. And there are lots of other big cities and other important targets in Iran. Well, I have no doubt that on a theological level, on an emotional level, Iran would love to wake up tomorrow morning and see Israel no longer there. And it's not just a matter of emotion. They are investing great efforts, great resources to doing this. The question is whether they are willing to go the whole way, risk national survival in exchange for the joy, the wonder of destroying Israel. And I must say, it really doesn't sound very, very logical. It doesn't sound rational. And bottom line, I tend to think that it will not happen. But I could be wrong. There have been one or two cases in history where experts have been wrong. And that's why Israel certainly has to treat the Iranian threat as if it is an existential threat. It has to take it as seriously as possible, as seriously as one takes an existential threat. But at the same time, the threat probably doesn't come from that level. It comes from lower level threats. It comes from various future scenarios, such as when there's the next round with Hezbollah. And note that I didn't say if there's a next round, I said when there's a next round, because I'm pretty convinced that it'll happen. That's what Hezbollah is about. Maybe the next round with the Syrians. That actually, if you look at some of the recent reporting, might not be as far off as we might have thought. Maybe in some future scenario, a few years from now, when the next round with Hezbollah takes place, and then either Israel hopefully has gotten its act together and does well compared to 2006 and is on the verge of a decisive victory, or Israel is not doing well again, and maybe in those circumstances the Syrians decide to get involved. It's now no longer just Israel-Hezbollah, it's Israel-Hezbollah-Syria. And if it's in the next few years, then I'm not worried about this. But at some point, there's a rumor that President Mubarak may no longer be the president of Egypt after 27 years. Maybe sometime in the next 10, 20, 30, 50 years, he will no longer be president. Well, maybe the Egyptians get involved as well. But that's down the line. So let me leave the Egyptians aside for the moment. What happens if during this future conflict the Iranians decide that this is now the time? They don't even have to out the program completely. They don't have to issue an explicit threat to Israel, an explicit nuclear threat. They can even hint at it. And the minute you bring nukes into the picture, it's a totally different ballgame. Totally. And that's why existential, maybe not existential, it's a dire threat. And dire threats are important enough. We don't always have to think in existential terms. If you look at the record, there's no indication that the United States and Israel, two extraordinarily close allies, have held to this day a serious policy dialogue on the Iranian issue. Now, there's clearly, and the sides say this explicitly, there's clearly a broad exchange of intelligence and a broad ongoing diplomatic exchange in the sense of what's going to happen next week in the Security Council or the IAEA or the Secretary of State is going to meet some foreign leaders, so there's a consultation, or vice versa, Prime Minister Olmert is going somewhere. That clearly exists in broad and deep terms. But there hasn't, if you look at the record, and if you look at, and both sides specifically deny that there's been a dialogue of the sort that I'm going to say in a moment, it doesn't look like there's been a dialogue on what I would say is the one major issue, which then breaks down into two parts. And the question is, what happens if and when diplomacy runs its course? And neither side believes at this point that the diplomatic route will indeed achieve the desired outcome. Well, when diplomacy runs its course, there are two options in broad terms. One is to take military action, whether it's an American or Israeli or a joint or a coordinated operation. And the other option is to find ways of living with a nuclear Iran. A policy dialogue of this sort does not seem to have taken place. And the study, which I had the pleasure of writing for the Institute, tries to explain why that might be the case. What are the obstacles to a dialogue of this sort? Most importantly, what we should really be talking about and how to get around these obstacles. And just to put it a little bit in perspective, it's not just a problem here between the U.S. and Israel. If those of you have had the dubious pleasure of reading Churchill's memoirs, I took on this endeavor a few years ago. Churchill describes his utter frustration and his ongoing frustration throughout the Second World War, at the height of the U.S. and British engagement alliance, his total frustration, his inability to conduct a serious dialogue with Washington about anything. They just won't really talk to him about the things. They won't really bring him into American thinking. Well, I've always thought that if the British had that kind of difficulty talking with the superpower, then certainly it's not surprising that Israel might have that problem. And frankly, sovereign nations are loath to really put their cards on the table, to really talk about their innermost thoughts, the innermost things that concern them. So the fact that this dialogue may not have taken place is not a major surprise. And when speaking to American audiences, the assumption is always that the impediments to dialogue are probably mostly on the Israeli side because Americans are willing to talk about anything, and I don't think that's the case. The problem is mutual. It's at least mutual. And let me make one other point before getting then to some of the specific issues. There is a fundamental difference between how the two sides approach this issue, which of course then colors how they actually approach it. For Israel, the Iranian nuclear program may indeed be an existential threat. It is certainly a dire threat. For the United States, it's a very important issue, there's no doubt. It has global implications, the future of the nonproliferation regime and half the world going nuclear, the future of the world's oil supply. It's no big issue, but I mean, if a nuclear Iran then has influence over all of the oil and gas supplies of the Middle East, well, it's just the world economy. It's not a biggie. For Israel, though, it may be existential. And it's in any event, far more severe. Well, what should we be talking about if there weren't these obstacles? First of all, we should be talking and are talking about preventative options on the diplomatic level, whether it's political or economic sanctions. That is being discussed, and there was a broad and deep dialogue on that level and has been for many years. And on this level, there are no problems in terms of talking. A second level is if and when the political and economic sanctions route runs its course, we don't immediately have to go up to direct military action. There are steps in between. For example, a naval blockade. I think Iran, for all its talk and its very good rhetoric, Iran is actually extremely susceptible or vulnerable to international pressure. Iran imports 40% of its refined petroleum products. Iran is a huge exporter of crude, but most people aren't aware that it imports 40% of its refined petroleum products. You can close down almost overnight the Iranian economy if you cease to sell them refined oil products. 80% of the state budget comes from the oil sector. If the world were to refuse to import Iranian gasoline products, again, you could shut the economy down, bring it to its knees without firing a shot potentially. So there's the diplomatic and economic sanctions, and there's a possibility of a naval blockade. And on this level, again, there's no problem of coordination between the U.S. and Israel. The U.S. doesn't need Israel for this. It would probably want to inform Israel of it, but it can do this unilaterally. The difficulties begin when we start talking about military action, whether it's American, Israeli, or as I said before, in some way coordinated. Here, both sides have serious difficulties in talking. And since the time is limited, I won't go into any detail, but just quickly to say, for example, if Israel was planning such an operation, well, would she want to come to Washington and say to the president, we're about to do this, or we're going to be doing it down the line? If you don't know the answer, you don't ask questions. Would the U.S. want to talk to Israel about a potential military strike of its own? Well, even talking about it can be, at the very possibility, could be construed by Israel as an American willingness to countenance such an operation. And Israel, since it's not going to be imminent probably, maybe that Israel will then consider this legitimization for going ahead and doing it on its own. If the U.S. doesn't intend, for example, to conduct a military operation, it again might not want to tell Israel, because that could be construed as legitimization. Well, if you're leaving us alone, then we're going to go ahead and do it ourselves, the Israeli side. If Israel doesn't intend to do it, it similarly would be hesitant to say that to the U.S., because the hope is that the U.S. or the international community will handle the problem, that Israel won't have to do it itself, and you don't want to take the pressure off. So there are a whole number of obstacles to talking about the military option. Well, what happens if the sides either jointly or separately come to the conclusion that they do not have an effective military operation? Now, here again, there's a fundamental difference, that there's absolutely no doubt that the U.S. has a military capability to hit all the targets. That's not a question. Mike raised the question before of whether Israel can do it. I don't think Israel has a problem reaching Iran. The question is whether you can do something effective, which will have a long-term impact. Well, the United States certainly can do it. The question is, what are the political diplomatic ramifications, the terrorist ramifications? But let's say that the sides, again, either together or separately, come to the conclusion that there's no effective military option and we have to live with Iran, with a nuclear Iran. Well, there are, I think it's four primary options for this. Yeah, four. The first one is an American security guarantee for Israel. Whether it's direct and it's explicit just for Israel, and it can be written, it can be verbal, it could be a security treaty, it can be a memorandum of understanding, it can be in a whole variety of ways. It's one possibility. Israel has never wanted an American security guarantee. It likes to go its own way. I'm not convinced that the United States is dying to give such a guarantee, but that's one possibility. A second possibility is a multilateral security regime or a multilateral security guarantee for Israel. If Israel, for some very good reasons, is hesitant to want a unilateral American guarantee, I think it would be most hesitant. I don't think there's any chance that it would be interested in a multilateral guarantee. A third option, Mike mentioned it before, is an end to Israel's policy of nuclear ambiguity. I think that there are very, very, very good reasons for Israel to have maintained this policy to this day, and there are no good reasons for changing it. And so I think that it's an unlikely option. And the final of the four is regime change. Well, people have been talking about regime change in Iran only since 1979. It hasn't happened since then, and I frankly don't see it happening anytime in the foreseeable future. In any event, the timeline till they reach the bomb and the timeline till regime change seems to be such that they will have the bomb way before the regime can be changed. So I think, in effect, we're only talking two viable options. One is the change in the policy of ambiguity, which, as I said, I do not believe will happen. And that really leaves us with only one, and that's the possibility of an American security guarantee for Israel. Well, again, here we run into difficulties in talking about them. Because if Israel agrees to even talk about an American security guarantee, this can be construed as a willingness to live with a nuclear Iran, and Israel does not seem to be at that point yet to be considering that possibility. And by the United States, for example, the fear could be that if the U.S. proposes to talk about this, then Israel will interpret it as an American intention to live with a nuclear Iran, to pursue a policy of containment and deterrence, not a policy of prevention, of ultimate prevention, military if necessary, and that this might then encourage Israel to go ahead and act on its own. Well, the study suggests a whole variety of ways to try and deal with the problems to dialogue. I won't go into it for lack of time. The NIE, which came out in December, the National Intelligence Estimate, I think will probably go down in history as one of the most fundamentally flawed documents ever published. But that's history. That's water under the bridge. I think it will have a huge effect on the outcome of the Iranian nuclear program. At least for the next, I would say, couple of years, if not longer, it looks like the United States is out of effectively dealing with the Iranian nuclear threat. And an NIE of equally strong, if not far greater, strength, clarity, whatever, will be needed to overturn the impression that this one has made. The U.S. has a hard time keeping the world community on board with this today. Certainly, the option of American military action or even a blockade, I think, has diminished dramatically. And one of the conclusions from this is that Israel is on its own. And that's a dramatic conclusion. And if ever there was a case, if ever there was a need for very, very close consultation between the United States and Israel, if ever the term strategic relationship had significance, this is the issue. And we may find ourselves in a position where it's very hard to hold this dialogue. Let me just conclude on a positive note, especially because Ephraim Sneh was quoted before. And I would just say that Israelis, American Jews, we have something of a tendency to sometimes overstate the dangers. And somewhere in the mind, in the back of our minds, I think many of us have a little bit of the boy in that famous Holocaust picture in the Warsaw Ghetto, the little boy walking with his hands up with a star on his chest. At least I think most Israelis carry that. The bottom line is Israel is a very powerful nation, and we have a broad array of capabilities. And while it's certainly a very serious issue and one which is worthy of your attention today and hopefully your activity beyond it, because it is the number one issue we face, bottom line is Am Yisrael Chai, and we'll get through this one also. Thank you.
I'd like now to provoke a couple of questions and perhaps some exchange amongst you on a number of the themes that emerged from your presentations. And then after a few questions of my own, then I will turn the floor over to questions from the audience. First, I'm going to ask an analytical question that emerged from Mehdi Khalaji's presentation. When I boil down a lot of what you had to say, Mehdi, it came down to the importance of the difference between President Ahmadinejad and Supreme Leader Ali Khamenei. Now, a lot of people who look at the Iranian nuclear problem say, if only we could get rid of Ahmadinejad, whew, boy, that would be a relief, and we will have solved, or at least dealt with, a big portion of this problem. Your analysis suggests something different than that, correct?
Yes.
Please tell us what you mean by that.
One of the irony of recent Iranian history is that Ahmadinejad made Ayatollah Khamenei very moderate, made it look very, very moderate, because Ahmadinejad was really unexpected phenomena even for Iranian people. Generally speaking, the president in Iran, they don't hold a very important position. Iranian supreme leader is not only a spiritual leader or even a political leader, but he's commander-in-chief of all armed forces. He's in charge of the intelligence services, he's in charge of Army Revolutionary Guard, he's in charge of national security and nuclear program, he's in charge of judiciary system. The president is only in charge of executive power, even in its authority over the executive power, he has not the full authority over it, and he has not the right to appoint some of key ministers of his cabinet. So presidents in general, whether reformist or radical or bureaucrat or whatever, they are not very important, they don't play very important role in Iranian politics in general. This is the supreme leader who has the final say on every crucial issue related to the foreign policy, to the nuclear program, to the military issue, and also on the domestic issues. So I think the role of Ahmadinejad has been overestimated by Western media and some politicians in the West, because the mechanisms of power in Iran requires that Ayatollah Khamenei as a supreme leader cannot leave with a strong president. Ayatollah Khamenei has his own mechanisms to weaken the president, whether it would be like Rafsanjani and somebody who is open to the economy, who advocates the free market economy and so on, or Khatami, somebody who advocates the civil society, who promotes the democracy and, you know, the dialogue between civilization and so on, or Ahmadinejad. A strong Ahmadinejad is a very big threat to Ayatollah Khamenei more than Israel, I think. So this is Ayatollah Khamenei, who has planned a very careful election, parliamentary election, which took place a couple of weeks ago in Iran. And the result was that this parliament is more critical of President Ahmadinejad, but more loyal to the Ayatollah Khamenei.
Mike, want to add something on this?
Yeah, I just wanted to add a point that comes out of Mehdi's presentation, which is something, which is a point that I've written about for a while now, but I think his presentation today makes the point even stronger, is that if the Supreme Leader hopes that Iran will play a leadership role in the Muslim world, Iran cannot play that role if it is, God forbid, flattened like a parking lot. And therefore, he has no interest in seeing the country. You know, sometimes people assume that the leadership of Iran has this martyrdom complex, and they would be willing to destroy the nation, the Iranian nation, in order to achieve their apocalyptic visions. And I think the experience shows that while they are willing to send thousands of young people to their death, perhaps, they do it in order to ensure the survival of the Islamic Republic.
Exactly.
And that has, I think, very important implications for the viability of deterring a nuclear Iran and a nuclear relationship between Israel and Iran. I hope we don't get there, but I think that's just that also strengthens some of the points that Chuck makes.
So if I understand the combination here, first, we shouldn't dance with joy if next summer Ahmadinejad loses the election for president, because he is not the key decision maker on the Iranian nuclear program in any case. And then secondly, your point, which Mike just reinforced, that Khamenei, his principal interest, if we look back in time and we try to extrapolate forward, his principal interest has been survival of the regime and survival of his own. Absolutely. And he may view attaining a nuclear capability as critical to his own and regime survival.
Absolutely. If I may, I want to add that the politics in Iran in recent decades has been changed from the bottom twice. Once in the course of Iranian Revolution, the second in the course of the election of Mohammad Khatami. In other cases, every political change comes from the top of the political structure. So any election takes place in the future doesn't change that much the nature of the regime and the power equation inside the Iranian government. This is the Ayatollah Khamenei who has the full control over the different branches of the government and different bodies of the government, whether military or nuclear or intelligence or executive or judiciary. So we shouldn't be excited or disappointed by any election in Iran, because the elections are not free and fair and are designed by the supreme leader to provide him with his own goals.
Patrick, on this?
The technocratic reformers in Iran, like former President Rafsanjani, are often regarded by the Europeans as our best hope for reaching a deal with Iran about nuclear matters. But we should bear in mind that Rafsanjani is a wily old goat, and his general approach is to be cleverer than Ahmadinejad in dealing with the foreigners. So Ahmadinejad's approach is to spit in the foreigner's eye, while Rafsanjani's approach is to blow smoke into their eyes. And what we have seen in the last 6 months, with Iran returning to cooperation with the IEA, in which they let in the IEA inspectors, has been a good example of the more Rafsanjani kind of approach, which is to pretend to cooperate in order to confuse the other side and divide them and see if you can't buy time so you move your program ahead. And Rafsanjani, in fact, shares most of the objectives of Ahmadinejad. When you get right down to it, both of them want to see Iran have a much greater influence in the region and in the world. Ahmadinejad is much more optimistic that this can be accomplished rapidly and dismisses the obstacles, whereas Rafsanjani is much more cautious and is indeed prepared to back off if it looks like the regime is going to be threatened. But there is not a difference on goals. And therefore, the best that we can hope for with this crowd running things in Iran is that we persuade them that the pursuit of their objectives is too dangerous for now, and that they should postpone it for another day. But there's not going to be a strategic meeting of minds in which we work out some kind of an agreement about how to achieve stability and regional security in the Gulf. That is not going to happen unless the United States makes the extraordinary decision that it really doesn't care who controls the world's oil supply, and it really doesn't care about the security of the state of Israel. And I just don't think that's very likely.
Before I turn to you, Chuck, if I could ask the flip side of this conclusion. This conclusion is Ahmadinejad, Khamenei, Rafsanjani, they share the same strategic goals. In terms of working to acquire a nuclear capability. They may have slightly different pace. One may be more influential than the others, but there's no fundamental difference among the leadership here in terms of the strategic goal. Now, we've often heard that on the other side of the coin, that Iran has the most pro-American populace of the region, that Iran has a people that is fed up with the Islamic Republic, that Iran, the Iranian people would like to change this regime if it could. Chuck stipulated, and I think with a lot of merit, that at the very least the timeline of triggering political change in Iran and of trying to stop the Iranian nuclear program they don't match. If the United States were to make a decision that it wanted to somehow take advantage of this raw political desire for change, is there something that we could do to embolden it, trigger it, give it sustenance, energy, and life? Gentlemen? Mehdi, yeah. Start there.
I think yes. There are many ways to help Iranian people to somehow get organized and have an effective political activity against the government. First of all, there are many mechanisms to support the civil society and NGOs in Iran because we know very well that Ayatollah Khamenei's biggest fear is the Velvet Revolution, the cultural invasion which takes place by not political activists necessarily, but by the civil activists, NGOs, and even women activists, union activists, bus driver activists, school teachers activists, all people who've been the subject of oppression in recent years can do a very important job in confronting the regime. Supporting the civil society and NGOs, and then having a good public diplomacy for Iranian people. Unfortunately, we have lots of difficulty in the U.S. with our public diplomacy for Iran. Even other countries, European countries, they don't have an effective public diplomacy for Iran. And even Israel does not have a good public diplomacy for Iran. I've heard last week when I was in London that because of the budget problem, the Farsi section of Radio Israel was on the, they wanted to shut it down, and the Prime Minister saved the section and gave $3 million to this section to continue its work. So it's very important to invest on the public diplomacy because many people in Iran, they don't know what is nuclear program and what is the Iranian regime's intention behind this program. I would disagree with lots of statements about the nationalistic advocacy of the nuclear program in Iran. I don't believe that what Iranian government wants to portray about what Iranian people want can be completely true. I think this is what Iranian leaders want to show, that the nuclear program is a very, very popular in Iran, and it's one of the basic components of the Iranian contemporary nationalism. I think no, many Iranian people, they don't even care about the nuclear program. And the most important significant and the most important and significant sign of this is that you cannot find any demonstration, any rally in Iran which taken place in the support of nuclear program out of government's network. Any demonstration in the support of nuclear program was organized by the government. There was no spontaneous move from Iranian people in order to support the nuclear program. So we have to have good nuclear, we have to have good public diplomacy in order to make Iranian people understand why international community is so concerned about the nuclear program, what Iran does in Lebanon and in Palestinian territories, because we have to use this opportunity that most of Iranian people, because of the hard economic situation, are very upset about the budget Iranian government spent in Lebanon and in Palestinian territories for Hezbollah and Hamas and Islamic Jihad. We have lots of opportunity in Iran to promote this cause, and just we have to improve the the public diplomacy. Just we have to spend some money for the support of the civil society and NGOs. And especially, I think, if any revolution takes place in future in Iran, it would be by the hands of women. And we have to invest on women movement in Iran and know that the future leadership of Iran is in the hands of women.
Patrick?
I want to underline something that Mehdi just said. We tend to forget what happened 20 years ago in those remarkable days of the autumn of 1989, when the Czech government fell in less than 2 weeks. And in less than 2 weeks, we went from seeing a solid communist government that looked like it was going to be in power for decades to Havel being the president of the Czechoslovak Republic and being greeted at the White House. And Khamenei speaks about this often. And his view also is that that's what came close to happening in Iran in 1997 after Khatami's election, and especially in the student demonstrations of 1999 when it really looked like power was about to change in Iran. And that is why he is so paranoid about what he speaks about very often, which is what he calls postmodern imperialism, the American plan to dominate the world through NGOs and through cultural influence of the United States. And that's why he throws a 67-year-old grandmother in jail, the head of the Wilson Center's Middle East program, in no small part for what she said at a Washington Institute forum. And in justifying that arrest, the Iranian television puts on a program in which they explain that George Soros and George Bush speak frequently to conspire together for their plan to overthrow the Iranian government. And they really believe this. I mean, Iranian television last month put on a program where they had actors playing George Soros and John McCain, who were meeting together at their weekly meeting to talk about what orders to give to the demonstrators in Iran.
Damn it, how did they find out?
And I like to say that Khamenei fears Hollywood more than Washington. But he certainly fears cultural invasion much more than military invasion. And this is an extraordinary problem for us in our plans to engage with Iran. Because anybody who's talking about engaging with Iran, it's really hard to figure out how you can engage with a government which is convinced that George Soros' activities means that you're trying to overthrow him. How are you going to engage with the government of Iran when you've got their intelligence ministers saying, warning on national television that any university professor who meets with a foreigner is a potential spy? I don't know what he thinks university professors do for a living. But given that paranoia, we're going to have real problems with engagement. And that's why some of the talk about engaging Iran, well, I wish them luck.
Before I turn to Chuck, Patrick's reference to President Havel in the Czech Republic gives me an opportunity to mention that we are also honored by the presence of the Czech Consul General, former Ambassador Daniel Cooperman, who served previously as Czech Ambassador in Israel. So, welcome. Chuck?
Yeah, I think we're giving a bit too much emphasis to personalities and maybe to hopeful prospects for things which are probably not going to happen. First of all, the nuclear program, the military nuclear program in Iran did not begin with the Islamic regime. It began under the Shah. And Iran has very good reasons as a nation. And if I was a Iranian strategist, and I'm not, but if I was an Iranian strategist, I would look around at the world and say, we've got some very good reasons for wanting a nuclear program. For 8 years, we fought a brutal, bloody war with Iraq, and we lost 400,000 people, and the Iraqis used chemical weapons against us, and the world didn't give a damn. And in the last few years, wherever we look, we find ourselves surrounded by either U.S. forces or U.S. allies, and these Americans don't play games anymore. In the space of 2 years, they toppled two Muslim regimes, and they talk about regime change in Iran itself. And they look at Israel, and it's interesting that there's a parallelism here. Israel is scared stiff of the Iranians. The Iranians are scared stiff of Israel. They have very good reasons for wanting a nuclear program, and I doubt highly that it's going to change even if a new regime takes over. The question is, to what extent they want this? Are they, to what extent they're truly committed to it? And the NIE recently raised the specter that maybe they are more susceptible to pressure than we had previously thought. I said before in my remarks that I think that under certain circumstances, Iran could be brought to its knees. I think that. I'm not sure that the international community is willing to go as far as would be required, but it could happen. But are they really, what is there, and what is the breaking point at which Iran would be willing to back down? It's certainly a very, very hard one. Now, I, for one, would very, very much like to see an American-Iranian dialogue tomorrow. I wish it had happened a year ago or a few years ago. Because we won't know until we try, until we are willing to put virtually everything on the table, make it totally and abundantly clear that there is a deal to be there, that Iran can normalize its relations with the United States and the West, that it can get all sorts of inducements in exchange for ending the nuclear program. Now, I tend to think that it will fail. I think it's worth a try, and I don't see the downsides to it. They're not major anyway. And only once we've gone through that exercise, especially in the wake of the Iraqi and WMD fiasco, can the United States then hopefully mobilize domestic opinion and international opinion for the more stringent steps, the semi-military ones, such as an embargo, and potentially even the military ones, only after we've gone through that process. So I think it's something which we have to see sooner rather than later. But getting back to the issue of what can we do to trigger regime change in Iran, well, I'm not very hopeful about it. The U.S. has been working on regime change in Cuba just since 1959, and we're just about there. And in North Korea since the 50s. And with the Soviets, it only took 70 years. We don't have 70 years. We probably don't have 70 months. It's not 7 months, but it's a lot closer to the 7 than to the 70. And let me just end my remarks here by quoting Mark Twain. I think it's the same thing here. As he said, the news of my imminent demise, or the news of my death, are premature.
Patrick?
I want to have some dialogue going. I basically disagree with everything Chuck just said.
Now it gets interesting.
The Washington Institute is a big tent.
Big tent. Dialogue can't hurt. The 1979 effort, where Mr. Brzezinski, as the National Security Advisor, met with Iran's Prime Minister and Foreign Minister in Algiers, led 4 days later to the taking of the embassy in Iran. Dialogue of McFarlane with the Iranians was the Iran-Contra affair, which was not a triumph for the United States. Our last two big attempts to have dialogue with Iran blew up in our faces, hurt the United States, and hurt U.S.-Iran relations. Dialogue with inappropriate expectations can profoundly hurt the United States. Regime change is utterly unpredictable. Country experts have not predicted successfully any regime change in the last 200 years. When Mr. Reagan stood in front of the Berlin Wall in 86 and said, Mr. President, this wall must go, Mr. Gorbachev, everybody thought the old man had gone dotty. That wall was gone in 3.5 years. We have no idea when regime change can take place. Iran is badly served by its nuclear weapons program because a country like Iran would do much better not to be isolated in its region and to have friends in its region, and it could do that. The reason it got invaded by Iraq was because it was isolated, and the reason Iran has such security problems is because it has no strategic friends whatsoever. By going down the nuclear route, Iran's launching an arms race that it's going to lose because it doesn't have the money and the powerful friends that provide it with advanced weapons. The reason that Iran is well served by the Non-Proliferation Treaty is the same reason that 180 other countries around the world are well served by the Non-Proliferation Treaty. Each country in isolation has reason to acquire nuclear weapons, but they don't live in isolation. They live in a neighborhood, and if their neighbors react through an arms race, possibly even a nuclear arms race, they lose. So Iran loses by acquiring nuclear weapons. Its national security is not helped by it.
Let me, I want to ask two more questions and then turn the floor over to you. And perhaps we'll have an opportunity to continue this debate. This really is a debate that is going to be on the presidential election campaign. You don't hear that much about it yet, but I suspect as September, October come around, this debate, engage, yes, no, if so, how, will be one of the most important issues in the foreign policy debate. But I did want to ask two more questions. Mike, let me ask you. You hear a lot of very smart people here in the United States saying, we know how to do deterrence. We deterred the Russians. We deterred the Chinese. These guys were just as crazy. Stalin was crazy. Mao Zedong was crazy. We've deterred some pretty crazy people over the last half century. So why shouldn't the United States rely on its time-tested, well-honed, experienced policy of deterring the Iranians instead of spending a lot of time and effort trying to stop the Iranians from achieving what they're going to achieve anyway? Why isn't that, or is that, a smart approach?
Well, I guess the way I would answer that is that they might be right, but I prefer not to find out if they're wrong. And therefore, I think it's very important that we do as much as we can in order to prevent such an eventuality coming around. It might turn out, for reasons that Mehdi and Chuck and myself and others have explained, that a nuclear Iran is deterrable. But, you know, I think the more we learn, for instance, about the Cuban Missile Crisis, which at the time, according to former Defense Secretary McNamara, was in his mind a textbook case of crisis management and brinkmanship. And then he attended these two conferences that were held in Cairo, Cuba, at the end of the Cold War, on the I think the 50th, it was the 30th and then the 40th anniversary of the Cuban Missile Crisis. And you had a lot of the principals there. In addition to McNamara, you had former Soviet officers, you had Castro and others. And his conclusion after attending the first conference was, you know, he didn't realize what a close-run thing that was and how close we were to nuclear war, to global nuclear war with the Soviet Union at the time, where you had Fidel Castro basically almost egging on the Soviets that if the United States attacks Cuba, he was going to try to get the Soviets in a nuclear war with the United States. You had situations where the United States was dropping signaling charges to the Soviet submarines that were approaching the quarantine line. And the Soviet submarines thought they were regular depth charges, and they had orders. First of all, we didn't know that the Soviets had nuclear-armed torpedoes on their ships, and that they had release authority to use them if the hulls of their ships were penetrated. And we now have the testimony of one of the captains. He was ready to launch, you know, his nuclear weapons because he thought his submarine was on the verge of being sunk because he thought the Americans were using regular depth charges, not these signaling charges. We also had this case of this U-2, which strayed over the Soviet Union at the height of the crisis, that it was on a reconnaissance mission, and it veered off course. And you know, Kennedy's response was, you know, there's always one SOB who doesn't get the word, and he kind of chuckled. McNamara thought that his fear was that the Soviets were going to think that this was a reconnaissance mission that was a pre-strike reconnaissance mission that was going to then be followed by waves and waves of nuclear-armed bombers. So McNamara's conclusion was that he didn't realize how close we were to losing control of this crisis. So I'm simply saying the Cold War record really isn't as good. All you need is one crisis that goes wrong to change the entire course of human history. And we now recognize that the Cuban Missile Crisis was a lot closer than we realized at the time. And, you know, because of certain aspects of Iranian decision-making, and it's not because the Iranians are irrational or because they have a martyrdom complex, but because you have the fragmentation of political factionalism that leads to tug of wars among decision makers. And because you have perhaps, Patrick talked about how the U.S. embassy was seized in order to kind of undercut those who are trying to reach out to the U.S. Now, the country is somewhat different at this time, and they have a better hold and better control over things, but you just never know when Revolutionary Guards, naval elements take an action in order to provoke things and make things worse. So I think that it might, deterrence might be doable, but the risks are just way too great for us to have a cavalier attitude about the viability of some kind of deterrent regime vis-a-vis the Islamic Republic of Iran.
Thank you. Let me ask the panel, start with Patrick if you'd like, about the other argument one hears quite frequently in Washington, which is preventive action. Oh my gosh, that would trigger the apocalypse. If the United States did something, or if Israel did something, World War III, it would be the end of civilization as we know it. That the Iranians have assets everywhere, that the Iranians will be like Samson and bring the house down upon them and upon us. And therefore, it's an option we shouldn't even begin to consider. Is that a reasonable analysis of the potential scenario?
Well, I actually bribed Rob to ask me that question, because outside you will find the executive summary to a study that Mike and I have written called The Last Resort, Consequences of Preventive Military Action Against Iran. And one of the things we do is, being scholars, we say, the United States has attacked Iran in the past. What happened then? Let's just take a look at what history teaches us. And in 1980, when the United States was thinking about a hostage rescue attempt, the Secretary of State at the time, Cyrus Vance, withdrew more than 900 diplomats from missions around the world because he was convinced that the apocalypse would come in the Muslim world if the United States launched a rescue attempt. And Cyrus Vance actually resigned on principle. The only case I'm aware of a Secretary of State ever doing that, because he thought that it was a mistake. The rescue attempt went ahead. There were no demonstrations or protests any place in the world. Or take another episode. Fast forward to 1996, when the Taliban overrun northern Afghanistan, kill 9 Iranian diplomats, slaughter several thousand Shia in a really disgusting genocidal slaughter. And these were close allies of the Iranians. And the Iranians, true, they mobilized 200,000 troops in the Afghan border. And at this time, the Security Council passes a resolution condemning what the Taliban have done. And this, mind you, is in the context of the embassy bombings in Africa, which led the United States to launch missile strikes against the Taliban regime, which was put the U.S. in the interesting position of being on the same side of the Iranians and going against the Taliban. And yet Iran did not launch a war. Which suggests to me that the Iranians actually can be pretty good about calculating where their national interest lies in these situations. And if the U.S. were to engage in a preemptive strike that had broad support around the world, because it was understood that the Iranians represented an unacceptable risk, then I would say that the apocalypse will not come. And that instead we may see something like the Iranian reaction after the United States accidentally shot down an Iranian Airbus in 1988. And the Iranians came to the conclusion that the United States was entering the Iran-Iraq war on the Iraqi side. 8 days after the shootdown of that plane, Ayatollah Khomeini, who had pegged himself on the slogan, war, war, war until victory, accepted a ceasefire with Iraq. So the key question is, who does the world blame for this preventive strike? Is it the crazy George Bush and the bellicose Americans who are at fault? Or is it the Iranians who provoked this crisis? That's going to be central for what happens after a preventive strike.
Any further comment on this?
I would just say, that being said, I have to say that right now, from the point of view of dealing with an Iranian response, we're not in a very favorable position, simply because we have 140,000, 150,000 potential hostages, so to speak, in the form of U.S. soldiers in Iraq, who are, you know, potential targets of Iranian retaliation. And whereas in the past, where Iran did not respond, it was because it was in a very unfavorable regional position and immersed in a war where it was fighting for survival, in the eyes of some Iranians. Right now, they're kind of sitting on top of the world from their point of view. So, I agree with what Pat said, but right now I think we're in a situation where it could be very difficult for us, and we're in a situation where if we were to act, we would probably not have a lot of sympathy from the rest of the world, unless Iran was to do something provocative first, which then would prompt an American response.
Chuck, just a quick word.
Well, slightly quick word.
I don't think it's a question here of who's to blame. I think you have to look, and it's not a question of PR, it's a question of capabilities. What are the Iranian capabilities to respond to an American attack or an Israeli attack? And in truth, it doesn't matter if the man on the moon does it, both the US and Israel will be blamed for it. In reality, the Iranian capabilities are quite limited. The 150,000 American forces in Iraq, I do not think, look like potential hostages in Iran. They look like potential attackers in Iran. And let's not reverse the order here of who's number one and who's number two. The United States is a global superpower. Iran is, at best, a moderate power, at very best. What can they do? They can give the U.S. a little bit more grief in Iraq. That's certainly the case. And I would imagine that some American embassies and maybe some American identified institutions around the world, maybe a branch of McDonald's, will go up in the air. But they can't really do much more. And if the U.S. is prepared for this, the U.S. can, I think, counter virtually anything they can do. I think they will open up with everything they have against Israel. It'll be missiles from Iran itself. It'll mean the entire Hezbollah rocket arsenal. It'll mean terrorism, Hamas, et cetera. I think that's a price that Israel will be willing to pay, and I think should be willing to pay in exchange for putting an end to the nuclear program.
Yeah, if I could just add to that. No, I mean, I agree with just about everything that Chuck says. I mean, I think, it has to be seen in perspective, and part of this complex calculus is saying, well, are we willing to trade perhaps a few hundred or maybe a few thousand people dead? And after 9/11, we know that, terrorist attacks can result in thousands killed versus perhaps tens or hundreds of thousands who could die if Iran acquires the nuclear bomb and uses it. And it's a very complex calculus. Part of it is also just how this will play domestically in the United States. And if, part of terrorism's power is its psychological impact. And if it results in several hundred or a couple of thousands of American killed in the course of a year or two, it could have a tremendously divisive effect on the American body politic, the way that the war in Iraq has. That, now another government, whether it's, the Bush administration or its successor, has taken us down another path, which just leads to a quagmire, endless open-ended war, and more hostility from the Muslim world. So it's on multiple levels, the impact, which could have an impact on our freedom of action in the future, these kind of recriminations. So,
well, I think you've heard several shades of the answer on this. It's a very interesting question. My own takeaway is, whatever the differences you heard between Chuck, Patrick, and Michael on this issue, the apocalyptic option is way overdrawn. And that, I think, the common analysis supports that. After our break, we're going to hear from General Ben Eliyahu, who will give a very specific overview from his special vantage point. But before we go to our break, I wanted to open the floor to questions from you. We have several mics that I think are around and about. You can see two mics on the far right. They're going to come to you. So please take the mic that comes to you. Put your hand up. Gentleman in the back with your hand up, you're first. Gentleman two rows in front, you're second. And then on the far left, I'm sorry, I can't see everybody very well, but on the far left right over there, you're third with the mic. If you could please keep your questions brief, So we have time for answers, and when you're finished with your question, please hand your mic back to the person giving it to you. If you could identify yourself, that'd be great, too.
This is Bahram Nuromit.
Yeah, that's okay. Just shout.
Yeah, I don't know if you can hear me.
That's working fine. Speak right into it.
Okay. So basically, we've been spending a great deal of time talking about deterrence. And by all accounts, the way I understand it, we are at least a year, if not more, away from Iran possessing a nuclear weapon. Why are we talking about deterrence when they don't have their nuclear weapon? Why are we not allowing the course take its way with all options in preventing them from getting there before we start talking about deterrence?
Well, actually, I think we were talking about the whole range of options. The deterrence, I'll let my colleague speak, but deterrence, for better or for worse, is a very commonly held view among many people in the foreign policy establishment. And so one has to evaluate its pros and its cons. But I think we spent considerable time talking about alternatives to deterrence. But gentlemen, you want to go into this?
I'll just make a very quick comment. First of all, for better or for worse, we might just find ourselves in a situation in a year, two, three, or four down the road in a situation where, this is the default policy option because the other options failed. So we have to, because of what we want to, in order to succeed in deterrence, you have to start laying the foundations now. There are certain things you need to do now in order to have a robust deterrent relationship with a nuclear Iran down the road. That doesn't mean that you are committing yourself to this course of action. We should be doing everything, and I think we are trying to do everything we can in order to prevent such an eventuality. But there are things that have to be done now in order to prepare for that possibility, because otherwise you might find yourselves unprepared. If you don't take steps now, you might find yourselves in a situation where you wake up one day to the reality of nuclear Iran and you haven't done everything you need to do in order to prepare for it, and then you don't have a robust or successful deterrence posture. So
before we preempt, we darn well better have in place assets that will make it hard for Iran to react. The Iranians talk, for instance, about closing the Strait of Hormuz. We better have in place assets which prevent them from doing that. Well, that means that before we preempt, what we have to do is exactly the same things we would do if we decide that we're going down the route of deterrence. So preparing for deterrence and preparing for preemption involve the same policy steps for now. So we aren't going to come to the moment where we have to decide which one of the two we're going to for a while. But we have to get in place things like an adequate defense of the Strait of Hormuz before we can do either one.
Yes, sir. Microphone. You're going to have to take the mic. I'm sorry.
The mic wins.
My name is... Hello?
That's fine.
Can you hear? My name is Renan Harari, and I'm visiting from Canada. And I just wonder if one of you guys can just talk to Russia or China and their influence in this matter and how they would weigh in.
Good question. Gentlemen?
I actually am convinced that the Chinese in particular are sincere when they tell us that they think the way to handle the Iran problem is through strategic patience and through inducements, because that's the approach that the Chinese adopt towards North Korea, which is something they care about more. Now, I happen to think the Chinese are wrong on this one, and that you got to have a stick as well as a carrot. But when dealing with something that they really care about, that's central to their national security interests, namely North Korea, the Chinese are acting like this way, which is inducements and strategic patience. With Russia, part of the problem is Russia doesn't care as much about proliferation as the rest of the world, because the Russians are used to being targeted by multiple countries. And part of the problem is that the Russians are firmly convinced that the Iranians are years, years away from having a nuclear capability. So we got time to deal with this one. To be blunt, the Russians don't see any particular reason to be helpful to the West. The main goal of the Putin government is to abolish the 1990s, and that's what matters above all. Everything else is way down the list.
If I could just add one thing, though, that's I think it's interesting. I'm not a student of Russian policy, but I think there is a they're also to a certain extent conflicted when it comes to Iran. That, you know, I think they recognize that the relationship they've had with the Islamic Republic since 1989 is within seen against the broad sweep of Russian-Iranian history, somewhat anomalous. That the relationship between the two has not been very good historically, and that there's the possibility that things could turn take a turn for the worse in the future. And in fact, that's one argument, I think, from their point of view of engaging and remaining engaged with Iran. But that's also an argument for being somewhat careful in their dealings with Iran, because Iran has the potential to do great mischief in the Muslim republics of the southern regions, majority Muslim regions of the of Russia, should they desire to do so in the future. So.
Okay, on the left. Yes, please. No. Of course, how could I possibly honestly answer the question? Okay. No.
Hi, I'm Esther Kandel. If any of you want to stop what you're doing and just go to the Hollywood world, you were so outstanding. I think you do very well. Thank you. Question. It seems to me we're damned as far as Israel goes and Jewish interests and even American interests worldwide and in Israel itself. We're damned if we do and we're damned if we don't. On the one hand, as Chuck said, we understand that if Israel does do a major strike for deterrence, they're willing to accept rockets on the northern border, stay abroad, et cetera. On the other hand, we're risking, as was said before, also possibly by Chuck, the unannounced possible radiation, dirty bomb type of, or even nerve gas or biochemical weaponry that could be launched against Israel if we don't do anything. So does anyone have a response to that?
Chuck? Yes, the question in brief was, it seems as though Israel, from Israel's perspective, Israel might be damned if it acts and damned if it doesn't act, that it pays a price either way. How does one evaluate the scenario? What does one do?
Look, first of all, it's not as if Israel has been passive on this issue. Israel has developed a whole variety of defensive and offensive capabilities over the years. It's pretty well structured to deal with the threat as it is today and as it may evolve over the coming years. There are going to be some very, very tough choices that have to be made in Jerusalem and in Washington in the next couple of years. It's not quite as dire as people tend to think. As I said before, it's not as if we're going to be wiped out the day after the Iranians go nuclear. If necessary, this is something that Israel doesn't want to contemplate, and I think understandably doesn't want to contemplate, Israel may have to live with this threat at some point. And then the question is just how you make that more palatable. If Israel is, as is thought, a nuclear power in its own right, then, for example, a strategic alliance with the United States isn't absolutely essential. On the other hand, it would certainly be nice to have. It would increase the threat that the Iranians perceive. It doesn't really matter if you're destroyed 5 times or 50 times over, but it would create an impression. There are a whole variety of ways that Israel can live with this if there's no choice but to do so.
If I could just add to that, you know, I grew up in the 60s, and I remember growing up under the shadow of nuclear war. And it's this is not something I commend to anybody, but it's a something we dealt with and we lived with. We managed, I think, against all expectations to overcome. I mean, and it gets back, to, I think, to, in a way, the point I made before, which again, it's not for me to give advice to Israeli leaders, but I think the issue of leadership is absolutely critical. And I would just say that I think it would be useful that if more often you heard statements like I think Shimon Peres made a comment a number of months ago that missiles go both ways, in talking about Iranian threats or in President Ahmadinejad's threats to Israel, that he reminded the Iranian president that missiles go both ways. And I think that's an important point to make, because as Chuck said before, although I'm probably more free to speak about this, Israel is a major regional power and has a significant nuclear arsenal. And, you know, God forbid we get to the point where, you know, someday it ever has to be used. But I think it's important to make that point because, again, as Paris said, missiles go both ways. So.
And also, it's not all over just if Iran gets a nuclear weapon or a couple. There are four countries that gave up nuclear weapons. We're actively negotiating with a fifth to do that. And the hope would be that if we put in place a vibrant and strong deterrent structure, that we can have the same result that happened during the Cold War, when we put in place a vigorous response to the Soviet intermediate missiles. The Soviets looked at this and said, you know, this doesn't work for us, and they agreed to give them up. So we hope that deterrence can be a way to persuade the Iranians that their weapons system won't bring them any advantage, and that we can put together an incentive package that will talk them into walking it back.
But again, even this discussion of deterrence is deterrence in the event that all of our common and collective efforts to prevent do not succeed. So one has to think down both paths simultaneously. Barbie?
Can you hear me now?
Yes. Okay.
Some of the things that you've said have been attempts at reassurance, I think. But it's my understanding that this coming Tuesday, Israel is having an air raid that will cover all of Israel except for Sderot and Ashkelon, where everybody goes immediately after they hear their signal to some kind of shelter. I think that there's news also that they're going to be reissuing gas masks that they had removed and take out of circulation. So Israel is taking it very seriously, and I want to know from each of your perspectives what you think is likely to happen if and when Iran does get the ability to produce nuclear bombs and missiles with the ability to deliver them. I also want to ask another question, and that is, why do you think they have so many centrifuges running and they want to have the ability to produce many bombs, not just one or two that could take care of Israel? Don't you think that it's a threat to the United States of America as well as to Europe?
Gentlemen?
I don't think that they're a threat to the United States and Europe. I think we've all become too gun-shy and too risk-adverse. If the Iranians ever so much as hint at any hostile intent, nuclear intent towards the United States, Iran will cease to exist in a matter of seconds. And if it goes beyond the hint, that's certainly the case. Let's put this in perspective. Iran is, by world standards, is not a major power. Iran compared to the Soviet threat, Iran compared to the Chinese threat, is a joke. Now, they may be less deterrable for another reason that wasn't mentioned before, is because it's a theocratic regime. And the minute you bring God into things, things do change. Maybe in some extreme circumstance, I don't know, maybe there are some people in Iran who think that the destruction of Iran is a worthy price to pay for the destruction of Israel, for example. It's really hard to imagine that. It's really hard. They're certainly not crazy enough. They're not crazy. They have an extremist policy. It sounds crazy to us in the loose sense of the word. They're not a crazy regime. They carefully calculate things. The Iranian regime actually, unlike most of the Arab autocracies, actually cares about its people. It's willing to sacrifice many, many, many thousands in pursuit of other goals. But it is a regime which actually is committed to its own people. It's not a Saddam Hussein who couldn't care about anyone other than himself. Mm. Israel has taken extraordinary measures to date and will continue to do so in the future. There was a joke that people tell in the government in Israel. When Israel bought the F-15Is, the long-range version, well, the I officially stands for Israel, but the joke was, well, actually it stands for Iran, that it reflects an Israeli intention. It doesn't matter. There's a whole array of offensive capabilities. There's a whole array of defensive measures. In point of fact, against a nuclear threat, the defensive stuff doesn't matter. It's worthless, because if one bomb gets through, that's it anyway. But if you were sitting in Tehran today, you would be at least as scared of Israel as Israel is, and many people in this room are, of the Iranians. And one of the problems we have is that we have these mutual fears feeding on each other, and they could get out of hand. But the fact is, Israel has built up a very robust capability.
You know, it's we went through a period after the end of the Cold War where these kind of discussions about, you know, throw weights and number of people killed in first strikes, you know, these kind of semi-pornographic discussions, we haven't had those in a long time, and I thank God that, you know, we've not had the occasion to do so, and it looks like, unfortunately, we're heading into a future where we have to. But I would just say that, look, we also know, looking at the North Korean and the Pakistani and the Indian weapons tests, that a good number of these tests were produced fizzles by our standards, that the weapons didn't function all that well. And these are weapons that are not at the, on top of missiles going undergoing great stress and strain. Now, that being said, you know, in the course of the delivery, so The having the capability to actually field and deploy these kind of weapons and have an effective capability is not a trivial matter. That being said, there is no decision maker on the potential receiving end of any of these weapons who's going to take a risk and saying, well, what if they, you know, how lucky do I feel today that, you know, that they're going to fizzle, that maybe they're not going to operate as intended. So, you know, having this potential will have a chilling effect on decision makers in neighboring countries. But again, as I think we said before, you know, Israel is a relatively strong country, a very strong country by regional standards, especially when measured in considerations that you look at when looking at nuclear deterrence. And the United States is a country that still has between 5,000 to 7,000 nuclear warheads. So I think, you know, again, I have, as I said before, I have great concerns about the viability of a deterrent relationship between Iran and any other country nuclear weapon state. But that being said, I think it's also important to, you know, take to heart what Chuck said, that there are very powerful, and the implications of Mehdi's analysis, that there are very powerful countervailing factors which make this a very difficult decision for the Islamic Republic. But again, the general trend lines in terms of greater proliferation in the region, you know, in the long run, it's a very sobering reality that we are facing in the coming decades, potentially. But again, as Patrick said, things go both ways, and programs have been walked back. So we don't know. We don't know what the future holds.
If Iran gets nukes or gets the capability to produce nukes, my great concern is that the global proliferation system, non-proliferation system, breaks down and many other countries get nukes. And we won't be up here discussing how to deter Iran. We'll be discussing how to deter Saudi Arabia, how to deter Egypt, how to deter Turkey, how to deter Chavez. I don't want to live in a world like that. That's my great worry. And I think it's important that we keep attention centered on that issue, because so long as the question is just how do you deter that one country, we dramatically understate what the problem is. But even on deterring Iran, Iran's a country with fragmented power to make decision making. The front pages of American newspapers debate about whether or not the Revolutionary Guard Corps supply of weapons to the insurgents in Iraq reflects a decision by the Iranian government. The Revolutionary Guard Corps controls Iran's nuclear program. And I can well imagine situations in which a nuclear weapon goes off and the Iranians say, oh my God, those rogue Revolutionary Guard units, how terrible, what do we have to do with it? So I think Chuck's right, that it's very unlikely that Iran would threaten the United States or Europe. But I don't want to gamble on that. And that's why I think it's worthwhile spending a couple billion dollars on a missile defense system against the risk of missiles coming from there. Because the consequences of being wrong on this one would be so horrible that we ought to have a defense system in place.
Last question over here, Marty.
I'd just like to follow up on what Patrick said. Where do you think the greatest risk lies? If Iran gets nuclear capability and the NPT essentially falls apart, is the greatest risk in something that Iran would do because deterrence failed? Or is the greatest risk in something that might have nothing to do directly with Iran but result from the fact that you had nuclear proliferation way beyond what you have today?
Personally, I worry about miscalculation and misperceptions. And I worry that in a world, you know, there was a, many years ago, an eminent political scientist who wrote an article in which he said that if countries got nuclear weapons, then they would become more serious and sober actors on an international scale, and so the world would be a more stable place. And one of his colleagues wrote a response and said, that's a wonderful theory. Let's apply that to automobiles. Let's tie sticks of dynamite onto the rear and front bumpers of every car in the world. And that way, we'll end automobile accidents because everybody will drive so carefully. In other words, I worry about miscalculation and misperception causing a war someplace. And I don't know where it would be, and it would be horrible wherever it is, because once nuclear weapons start becoming an acceptable aspect of warfare, that's not a world I want to live in.
Just like to, just one comment. I'm less concerned with global proliferation, not because it's not the threat that Patrick is portraying. I agree with him completely. But because the more immediate threat and the threat that I'm more concerned about, at the risk of sounding parochial, but I am, is the threat to Israel. And that is a, well, not immediate, but it's a near-term threat. And if it happens, it could be a potentially existential one. I think that's the primary danger that we should be focusing on today. And at the same time, I think the primary threat isn't that Israel's going to be wiped off the earth by a nuclear attack. The problem is how an Iran with a nuclear capability, with the ability to threaten the use, but not to actually use nukes, how that affects Israeli decision-making in future conflicts. If Israel in some future conflict, for example, is advancing on Damascus, and the Iranians come along and say, uh-uh, you stop, or you guys withdraw, or they come in some sort of other crisis and try and dictate terms, that's the real threat that I think we should be looking at.